produce it downwards. Although things are lightening up and improving, COVID-19 hasn't gone away completely. We are still required to follow certain COVID requirements, and that is why I am now standing at the front of the sanctuary making an announcement to you, as you have become used to. First of all, it is still the law that you must wear a face covering at all times in the church. The face covering must cover both your nose and your mouth, otherwise it is no use to anyone else, and it does not protect them from the risk of contracting COVID-19. The only exception to that is people who, as I am at the moment, have to speak publicly, and that is mainly just myself and the reader, as we have things arranged at the moment. And when you come up to receive communion and at the offertory, I will give you the procedure to do that. We still have a ban on congregational and community singing, I'm afraid, so you will have to allow the choir to sing for you. We hoped to have a full choir today, but for some unaccountable reason, the rules on choral singing have been even more restricted since last Monday, and so we are only allowed to have 6 singers at any one time. We are not in a position to pretend, as some other people do, that because we give our choristers pocket money, they are professionals, so we are sticking to the rules. And we have the great joy this morning of having 3 senior trebles. We haven't heard the trebles since Christmas Day, and also our 3 choral scholars who are providing the music. And if you were here to hear their rehearsal, you will know how excellently they are about to do so. Please do not be tempted to move around during the service, but we have loosened up a little, and if you wish to follow the instructions on standing, sitting, and if you wish kneeling during the service, please now feel free to do so. The only exception to that is please sit down when the choir is singing. That's also another part of the rules which we have to follow until the 21st of June. So that is presenting it to you as it is. There will be no collection taken. If you have brought an offering and haven't put it in the plate in the center of the aisle, please feel free to do so as you leave the church. Today the church remembers the coming of the Holy Spirit. O thou who camest from above, Wesley's hymn goes, the pure celestial fire to impart. And so as the choir begins by singing that hymn, let us pray for ourselves and for each other, that that pure celestial fire may burn in each one of us.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Alleluia! Christ is risen! Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." The eagle-eyed among you will have seen that after I incensed the altar this morning, I also incensed the Paschal candle. In liturgies gone by, the Paschal candle would disappear at the Feast of the Ascension, the risen Christ having been taken away from the disciples. In the liturgy of today's church, the Paschal candle remains until Pentecost. The reason being that Pentecost is the fulfillment of everything that Christ did. Pentecost is the fulfillment of his passion, his death and his resurrection, his teaching, his healing, everything that he has given us as a legacy, a living legacy for today. And because the Paschal candle goes off to be by the font and to be lit every time someone is baptized, and because the Paschal candle comes back out on occasions when people are buried, doesn't mean that the risen Christ has gone away. The coming of the Holy Spirit is not an end. It isn't an end to Christ's work. It is a beginning of Christ's work within you and me. The love which existed from the beginning between the Father and the Son in the Holy Spirit, that love is alive in us, and we celebrate that today. So as Christ comes to us in word and sacrament, and as the Holy Spirit sends and leads us out in order to be Christ's presence in the world, let us ask forgiveness for the times when our actions and our attitudes, our way of life, have been a danger to that witness, and when Christ's love has been cast out because of our sin. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
Sending to them the light of your Holy Spirit. Grant us by the same Spirit to have a right judgment in all things, and evermore to rejoice in his holy comfort, through the merits of Christ Jesus our Saviour, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in their native language. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own language, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Saint John. Jesus said to his disciples, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father, he will testify on my behalf. You also are to testify, because you have been with me from the beginning. I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me, yet none of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your hearts. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because they do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father and you will see me no longer. About judgment, because the ruler of this world has been condemned. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own, but will speak whatever he hears, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, because he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. For this reason, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you." This is the Gospel of the Lord. And of the Holy Spirit. One of my earliest memories of Saturday afternoons is listening with my father to the football results on Grandstand, read of course by the wonderful Len Martin, or occasionally, when the TV was on the blink, by the equally wonderful John Webster on the wireless. Both of these unsung stars and their successors developed a way of reading the results which alerted the listener to the type of result: home win, away win, draw, and later even score and no score draw. Younger football fans of today might be intrigued to know that we had no particular interest in supporting any of the football teams who were playing. After all, we had our own rugby team to follow. The point was to mark off the pool's coupon. If you had 8 draws, or 7 in the remote event that these were all the games drawn on that Saturday, you were in for a big win. One Saturday it did look as if we had 8 of them, and we hurried home to my mother with the good news, only to have her check the coupon and find a couple of them had been marked off by mistake. The football pools were at least as big as the national lottery is today, and for the same reason. People, especially those who don't have too many pennies to rub together, like to have some sort of hope of obtaining something better in life. Even those who may not wish to admit it have a remote hope of a day when there is enough money for bills not to matter and every need to be easily met, when a parent never has to say no to a child and life can become one long holiday. This is perhaps the best evidence of all that human beings don't always know what's best for them. In fact, the tendency seems always to look for miracles somewhere, at some time other than this place and this time, which is sadly distracting from the signs and wonders that lie before our eyes now and beneath our feet now. In fact, a common criticism levelled against Christians by the sneering classes is that we believe in miracles. Now, I have met my fair share of people and heard my fair share of sermons and testimonies from people who are convinced that if you pray hard enough, a parking space will appear where there was none, or that God will provide every little detail for your personal convenience simply because you are filled with the Holy Spirit. I have also found myself trying to help such people back to faith in God when they realise that this particular notion of God genuinely doesn't exist. And why should it? Nowhere in Scripture do we find a God who has the least interest in arranging the world to suit us. The signs and wonders associated in Scripture with the work of Jesus and the coming of the Holy Spirit are of a completely different order. They are the miracles of nature, not miracles above nature. In fact, the Christian faith is neither superstitious nor is it about the supernatural. The incarnation is the pledge that God is with us, and the Holy Spirit is the very abiding presence of God with and in us. This makes everyday life special in itself, however dull and miserable it may be, and however the injustices and inequalities of human society have degraded it. Without taking away a proper aspiration for material betterment, Christian life in the Holy Spirit is about valuing the things which matter and rejoicing in the small as well as the great everyday miracles. This may be as simple as a pain-free day, or something new learned, a relationship healed, an operation successful, or as basic and everyday as a hope restored following prayer or Holy Communion. It is the eye, the vision of the Holy Spirit, that makes it possible to see these everyday miracles. In the terms of today's reading from Acts, it is the eye of the Spirit that can tell the difference between a bunch of louts already or still drunk on the morning of a festival and a group of people so filled with the love of God that language is no barrier when they begin to speak of it. For the life and the vision of the Holy Spirit are accompanied by something which goes beyond words, and which Jesus has proven goes beyond even death. Something that overcomes every limit and barrier thrown at us by life. This is the love of the Holy Spirit, which is the very life of God. Robert Bridges gives it apt and beautiful expression in his version of the ancient hymn, "Love of the Father, love of God the Son, from whom all came, in whom was all begun, who formest heavenly beauty out of strife, creation's whole desire and breath of life." This is where we, as a church, as a Christian community, need most to pay attention. If we are alive to and aware of the small miracles of love that are present in the events of every day, And if we are willing to live and behave according to the spirit of love abiding in us, then we will be carrying out and modelling the outward mission of the Church, which showed itself to the world on that first Pentecost. Great events and initiatives are soon forgotten. Small acts of love are not. They are the things that transform life. They are the things that draw people of all ages to find out why these Christians love one another, where we find the strength and endurance to abide in love, and what the source of that love really is. Mission, like miracles, is really quite a simple thing. The Holy Spirit came upon the first friends of Jesus to enable them and send them to do God's work. The Holy Spirit comes upon us today for the work of God. If we will but live the life of the Holy Spirit, see with the eyes of the Holy Spirit, and abide in the love which is the Holy Spirit of God. Hope of all comfort, splendour of all aid, that does not fail nor leave the heart afraid, to all that cry, thou dost all help accord, the angel's armour and the saint's reward. Amen. Now, in the strength and the unity of the Holy Spirit, let us stand and profess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. United in the company of all the faithful and looking for the coming of the kingdom, let us offer our prayers to God, the source of all life and holiness. Diocese of Derby, we are asked to pray today for the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And in the Anglican Communion cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Melanesia. On this day of Pentecost, we pray for the work of the Church throughout the world. We pray for the gift of the humility and the love which make the witness of the Church in the Holy Spirit credible to others. We pray for those who are
seeking peace in the Middle East, for all who feel endangered or oppressed there and elsewhere in the world. We pray for those who are still suffering in great measure as a result of COVID-19 and its variants. We pray for the generosity of the nations which have vaccinations to spare. As we remember those who are sick, we pray for those who have asked our prayers by name, for Julie Weeks, Baby Thea, Liz Parker, Joan Lydgate, John Robinson, Sheila Laverick, Valerie Alice Seeley, Richard Harrison, Tony Reagan, Sandra Jones, Daisy Wallace, Christopher Brown, members of the Wolf Kid family, Paul Taylor, Anthony and Katie, Margaret, Tom Pierce, Ray Hearn, Jean Maiden, James Stretton, Kenneth Hughes, Robin Glasson, Laura, Jane Jackson, David Staves, Sue Hastings, Teddy, June Frankland, Patricia Mitchell, Michael Catton, and John Herring. And as we remember those who have gone before us in faith, we pray for those whose year's mind occurs in the course of this week, for William Rosling, Michael Graham, Ruth Morehouse, Monica Knighton, Lily White, Margaret Hopkinson, William Dickens Slaney, Judith Bowler, John Webster, Jenny Harding, Francis Smith, Dorothy Robinson, and Arthur Clarke, and also for Robert Marriott, recently departed. Merciful Lord, strengthen all Christian people by your Holy Spirit, that we may live as a royal priesthood and a holy nation to the praise of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Lord, in your mercy, bless Libby and Malcolm, our bishops, and all ministers of your church, that by faithful proclamation of your word, we may be built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets into a holy temple in the Lord. Lord, in your mercy, give to the world and its peoples the peace that comes from above. We pray for Queen Elizabeth and all who serve in elected office under her. May they find Christ's way of freedom and life. Lord, in your mercy, hold in your embrace all who witness to your love in the service of the poor and needy, all those who minister to the sick and dying, and all who bring light to those in darkness. Lord, in your mercy, touch and heal all those whose lives are scarred by sin or disfigured by pain, that raised from death to life in Christ, their sorrow may be turned to eternal joy. Lord, in your mercy, remember in your mercy all those gone before us who have been well-pleasing to you from eternity. Preserve in your faith your servants on earth. Guide us to your kingdom. Grant us your peace at all times, and hasten the day when many will come from east and west, from north and south, and sit at table in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, we give you thanks for the Blessed Virgin Mary and for the whole company of your saints in glory, with whom in fellowship we join our prayers and praises. By your grace, may we, like them, be made perfect in your love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. I now have to tell or remind you of the procedure for Holy Communion.
If you wish to receive communion, please remove your face covering in your place and come up in a single file up the centre of the central aisle, maintaining a 2 metre distance from everyone else at all times. When you arrive at the chancel step, I will be standing here with a face covering on. Do not say anything to me, and I will not say anything to you. That is in case anything nasty is attached to either of us, to ensure there is no risk of our passing it to one another. Please extend your hands as far as you can in front of you and keep them entirely flat. We don't want the sacrament to be dropped, and I would ask you, particularly in my case, because my hand-eye coordination is no good, please keep your hand still and do not try to grab the host with your thumbs or scrunch your hands, at least until I have removed my hand out of the way. If you touch my hand, we have to go through an elaborate procedure of sanitization, and that will hold everyone else up and not add to the dignity of the proceedings. Please receive communion as you are standing there. Do not walk off with the host. Communion is still under one kind, under the form of bread. When you have received, please walk off to the sides and return to your place through the side aisles. If necessary, going through the back of the church and back up the central aisle. Please be patient. Keep 2 meters distance between yourself and everyone else at all times. There is no rush, and it would be a sign of courtesy to everyone if you come up starting from the front and moving towards the back, and that will help with the movement of people as well. Thank you for your patience in both hearing and heeding those requests. Now let us stand, and with the Holy Spirit present around us and in us, let us share Christ's peace. The peace of the risen and ascended Lord be always with you. You are holy, indeed the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for men for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather together into one in your kingdom all, who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
United in God's Spirit, let us pray to the Father in the words that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Alleluia! Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia! faithful God, who fulfilled the promises of Easter by sending us your Holy Spirit and opening to every race and nation the way of life eternal. Open our lives by your Spirit that every tongue may tell of your glory through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The final COVID announcement, if you have touched any of the paperwork which has been set out in your pew, please either take it away in the case of the pew sheet or leave it in the quarantine box in the case of the attendance card, the order of service, and that includes the pen. Please do not make us have to print more orders of service than we need to. The pew sheet is very useful to you in seeing what is going on and also in praying together with the parish, the diocese, and the church throughout the world each day. Please do make sure that you maintain a 2 meter distance from each other as you leave. If you decide to mingle within the building, there is a limit of 6 people in any one group, and unless you happen to be groups of families, well, I don't think we've got anybody who's going to be like that, so I won't make it too complicated. Since it's not raining, you can gather in groups of however many you like outside, so perhaps it's best if you leave as soon as you can and gather outside if you want to have a good natter and a catch up. And I will be outside as well as an additional attraction. But the most important thing when we leave this place is to be conscious of the fact that we, through being here today, whether we feel like it or not, have been filled with God's Holy Spirit. Whether we have received communion or not, we have been filled with God's Holy Spirit. And being filled with God's Holy Spirit, we are to bring his life, his vision, and his love into the world in which we live. It is so simple, and it would be so catching, more catching than COVID even, for the people around us, if only we went out and did that. So as we ask God's blessing, let us pray once more for ourselves and for each other, that we may recognize the Spirit within us and that we may be used in the mission of God because of that Spirit. May the Spirit, who hovered over the waters when the world was created, breathe into you the life he gives. May the Spirit who overshadowed the Virgin when the eternal Son came among us make you joyful in the service of the Lord. May the Spirit who set the church on fire upon the day of Pentecost bring the world alive with the love of the risen Christ. And may the blessing and the love of the Lord the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Let us go forth in peace, alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ, amen, alleluia, alleluia. Thank you.
everyone.